Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your love and your light. We come before you with gratitude. Lord, we need you, and we cry out to you this morning, for you are great, and you are holy, and we love you. Lord, bless each and every one of us this morning. Speak to us. May we glorify you in your name. Amen. Well, good morning, and welcome. I'm glad all of you made it this morning for this very special morning. Like I said, I'm very glad you guys made it this morning. Quick, before we get started, I just wanted to send a shout out to our band. Janet, our wonderful director of music here, put it together. So I'm going to introduce you guys if you want to wave when I say your name. We have Sebastian Alfie on guitar. We have Lauren Gordon and Jacob Wildman on vocals. We have Tom Hunt on bass. We have Brian Longham on drums. And of course, our very own Janet Johnson on piano. So just a quick thank you for them for coming out here. A couple more quick announcements. When we're done with the service today, if we could get some volunteers to help clean this up, that would be much appreciated. We can give you more details after the service. This service is a little informal. It's a lot different than we normally do, as most of you know. As such, we're not going to ask you to stand up. I would like to let the Spirit lead you all in our times of music. If you want to stand, that would be great. If the Spirit leads you to, if you want to stay sitting down, whatever the Spirit tells you to do, it's perfectly acceptable and a good thing. One more quick thing. There are baskets in the back of the room. We're not going to have a normal offering for the church this morning. So as you leave the service this morning, if you want to place your offering in those baskets. There are a couple other announcements in your handout, so be sure to pay attention to those. And then Pete has one more announcement before we get going.
I haven't been this relaxed on a Sunday morning in 3 years. This is what retirement's going to be like. It's amazing. It's amazing. Well, my only announcement is Kevin, this summer, is going to be playing basketball for Christ. He really is. He really is. He's going to be with an organization called Uncharted Waters. Am I right? And part of his responsibility in doing that work is that he has to cover some personal expenses related to his venture this summer. And so I'm asking us to just put in a free will donation to assist Kevin with his expenses this coming summer, and we're just going to pass around some baskets. As you're able to contribute, fine, and if you're not, that's also fine. Just it's a free will offering. Because we are grateful for Kevin as having been and still continuing to be for a short time left our intern. I have threatened to flunk him in his internship, which would be a way to keep him for another year, right? Yeah. Can I do that? Okay, Kevin, I won't do that, okay? Because we're just so glad we have him.
So at this time, we are going to pass those baskets around. Janet's going to play a song, so as the Spirit leads you.
Thank you.
Now, will you please join me in the call to worship? The words will be up here. Your response will be in yellow, or you can follow along on your bulletin. Your response will be in bold. Praise the Lord, my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name.
Praise the Lord, my soul, and forgive not all his benefits.
Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases.
And redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion.
Who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles.
The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed.
Because he is good.
All the time.
Yes, all the time.
God is good.
Good morning, everyone. How are you guys? Doing good? dancing, homework, geography. Samuel, you ate anything? You don't know? You guys hate anything? Yeah, what do you hate? When people brag. Oh yeah, that is annoying. What about you? Do you hate anything? Homework? Yeah, I hate homework too. Do you guys have enemies? No? No enemies? Well, that's good. Would you hate your enemies if you had any? Probably, yeah. Benjamin, you're saying yes. Well, you know, Jesus told us that when we have enemies, we shouldn't hate them. What did he tell us we should do with our enemies? Love them? Yeah. Yes, Milo? Make friends. Ooh, I like that. Yeah, we should make friends of our enemies. How do we do that? That sounds really hard. Yes, Ollie? Yes, Ollie said we should be nice to our enemies even though they're mean to us. Any other ideas? Yes? Share? Oh, definitely. Oh, make amends. Yeah, fix the problem. Yes? Yeah, tell them how you feel. Those are all really good ways to love our enemies. Can we pray for them too? Definitely. Let's pray for you guys now. Will you join with me and repeat? Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for your love in every area of our life.
Thank you for our love in every area of our life.
Help us to love the way you have.
Help us to love the way you have.
We love you, Lord.
We love you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much for coming up and spending time with me. At this time, will you please stand up and pass the peace of Christ with one another?
Thank you.
that it was said, you must love your enemy and hate, you must love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemy and pray for them. Pray for those who harass you, so that you will be acting as children of your Father who is in heaven. He makes the sun rise on both the evil and the good, and sends rain on both the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love only those who love you, what reward do you have? Don't even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing? Don't even the Gentiles do the same? Therefore, just as your heavenly Father is complete in showing love to everyone, so also you must be complete. These are the words of the Lord for the people of our Lord. Thanks be to God. I hate Christian Leitner. You remember him, right? Back in the early 90s, 92, I think, when he was playing Kentucky. He was a Duke player. And it was in the Final Four, Elite Eight. And he made that shot over Kentucky to send them into the Final Four. Man, I hate that guy. Oh, and speaking of college basketball, I hate John Calipari. I'm sure you guys can understand with that. I mean, he ruined KU basketball back in 89, and then he went and beat them in 2012 for the national championship. Man, I hate that guy. Oh, and Tom Brady, hate that guy too. 5 Super Bowls. Gosh, that guy is so annoying. I'm sick of him. And Bill Belichick too. Both of them, ludicrous. I hate them all. Oh, and Grayson Allen. I got some class. Okay, yeah. See, you guys understand my hate. He kicks people. He's just the worst. Am I right? He's the worst. Isn't it interesting that sports make it easy to hate people? I just listed 5 people I've never met, and I hate them all. Just unadulterated hate. Pure hate. And it can take one play or one game. I remember back in 2012, the Broncos were playing the Ravens in the playoffs, and Jacoby Jones beat the Broncos defense and sent them into the next round of the playoffs. Man, I hate Jacoby Jones. And it only took one play. But there was also deep-rooted hatred. Think about Auburn, Alabama. Do you remember a few years ago there was that tree that was planted between the two campuses, and some guy, I think he was an Auburn fan, killed that tree? Oh, and then, guys, let me tell you. I've talked about the Broncos a couple times. Well, I hate the Chiefs. And I've hated the Chiefs since I was born. I was raised to hate the Chiefs. In fact, just the other day, I thought I've been getting better about this. Turns out I haven't been. Just the other day, I was talking about football with my roommate. And it just came out how much I hate the Chiefs. And, you know, I've been working on this and working on this about getting rid of this hatred, but it's still so deep-rooted in me that I can't get rid of this hatred of the Chiefs. In fact, this hatred is encouraged. Let me give you some examples. They make "I hate the Yankees" shirts. They make shirts that literally say "I hate the Yankees." People said that this hatred fuels sports and makes it better. They cheer on fights during baseball games. Players, like in the NBA, when LeBron moved from the Cavaliers to the Heat, man, he was the villain for a couple years. And then when Kevin Durant moved from the Thunder to the Golden State Warriors, now he's the villain, and everybody likes hating him. It just rises the ratings for sports. Oh, and do you remember back in 06, there was Steve Bartman, the fan who caught the foul ball during the playoffs for the Cubs that would have won the game for the Cubs? Oh man, I hate that guy too, and you know, other fans of the same team hate him as well. Isn't it all a little absurd? I just spent, I don't know, 5 minutes spewing all this hate. Why? Why do I have all this pent-up anger and hatred toward people who play a game? We've never met these people. We certainly have There are enemies because they throw around a ball or they do things on a field or a court that we just don't like, that offends us. So we consider them enemies and we start hating them. And we hate fans of other teams as well. I know, speaking from personal experience in college, since this is Chiefs Kingdom, right? I have been very angry at people wearing Chiefs gear for no reason, no good reason, other than they're wearing a red shirt. It doesn't make sense. People pick colleges based on the sports that they like or don't like. KU fans would never go to Missouri, am I right?
Right.
Or Kansas State? Never met them, and they don't persecute us. They don't do anything, as Jesus said in the Common English Version, they don't do anything to harass us. They don't hurt us. We just don't like the way they play a specific sport. But that doesn't mean we look past that, because we still have this hatred. Now, sports, I would be the first one to tell you guys that sports glorify God. They absolutely glorify God. It's a huge testament to God's power that he can create athletes who can do such amazing feats on field. But when we start hating people, when we fabricate enemies out of people we've never met and then spew hatred toward them, we go completely against the words Jesus spoke to his disciples. Now, Jesus knows something about having enemies. He had real enemies. I'm talking the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes. These people did harass Jesus. They tried to twist his words around to make it sound like he was lying or crazy or boastful. They tried to catch him in traps, and eventually they crucified him. But let's not forget that you and I, at one time, were also Jesus' enemies. We were the ones who shouted insults as he hung on the cross. We were the ones who nailed the nails into his hands. We were the ones who criticized him like the thief on the cross, saying, "If you are the Son of God, then surely you can come down." That was us. We like to say that it was other people, but our sins put him on the cross. And still, he prayed for us. He still said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He prayed for us as he was tortured, brutally tortured, the worst death in history, and he was still thinking about his enemies. We were still his sinners. We were still sinners. We were still his enemies. I have a question for you all. Are you right now willing to give your life for Grayson Allen? Because Jesus was, and he did. And he gave it up for all of us. And that's what love looks like. For enemies and friends alike. And he calls us to love like he did. He calls us to love our enemies. For what good are we if we don't love our enemies the same way we love our friends? He calls us to pray for our enemies the way he did while he was on the cross, saying, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He calls us to put our enemies' interests before our own. When we see someone in need, even if we don't like them, Jesus calls us to reach out to him or her and lend a helping hand. But there is good news. That was a lot of weight, but there's great news, because Jesus did die, and he rose again, and he's not asking us to do something that he hasn't already done. Because he defeated our sin by resurrecting, because he came back to life, because he rose from the dead and defeated the death, since and now death has no more stain. He's creating us new. Paul says that when we are in Christ, we are a new creation. And he creates us to be more and more like him every day. That means loving more every day, giving ourselves up more every day with his power. He promised to give us the help and the strength that we need through the Holy Spirit. So I have a challenge for all of you. Love everybody, even when it's hard, and be perfect, and be complete in your love for one another, as your Father in heaven is for us. Amen.
Amen.
God, I give you
this morning we have a few new joys and concerns that we need to lift up. First is Steve Nelson, who lives in Colorado Springs. He had a stroke, and he's in very serious condition. He's the nephew of Richard and Barbara, so we lift Steve Nelson up. Next, Sue mentioned this on her email. Darby Bates, he's a 7-year-old son of Justin and Kelly who attend First UMC West Campus. He has a genetic muscular degenerate disease, and it's getting harder and harder for him to move around. They recently just moved into a one-story house to make it easier for his mobility. So we lift him and his family up. Trudy mentioned this to me just a few minutes ago. Her uncle, Joed Tall, passed away last night, so prayers for him and his family. I believe that is all of the new joys and concerns. We celebrate birthdays of Andrew Hansen, Janet Phelan, and Karen Jones this week. And then ongoing prayer concerns from Arlen Knapp and Becky Harris this week. Church that we're praying for, Melvern and Queenimo, and Daekyu and Kim. They're the Korean church that meets here in the afternoon, so we'll lift them up. I have a joy. There were a lot of people who made this service happen, and I just want to send a quick thank you out to them. Missy did a ton of work. JJ did a ton of work. Joy did a ton of work. Obviously, Janet and the rest of the band have done a tremendous job. So I want to just give some thanks and a quick shout out to everyone. And of course, Pete does a lot for this church, and you guys have been tremendous in all you do. So just a quick thank you for all of you. And now, will you join me in a word of prayer? Lord, you give us such joy. Your name is blessed and holy. You are righteous. And we stand before you in awe, and we marvel at your majesty. We give you thanks. We give you praise, that you may be glorified for all the world to see, and beyond this world. We thank you for the many people in this church, the way you touch our lives, and the way you minister to one another, the way you send your spirit to us and between us. God, it's awesome. We just thank you for it. We celebrate birthdays this week, Lord. Testament to your love, your strength to sustain this world that you have created. We thank you. Lord, we come before you with concerns in our heart, spoken this morning and unspoken. Each and every one of us has things going in our lives. And I lift them all up to you, whether we said them on the microphone or not. There are people around the world, Lord, who don't have food, don't have water, who are in immense suffering. We lift them up to you too. Lord, you remember us better than we remember you, and we thank you for that. Forgive us for all we do. as you depart from this place, remember the love that God has shown you, and remember to give it back to all people, no matter if you like them or not. Go in peace. Amen.